Now let us see an example of how coroute shading may be implemented in a shader. So here is a vertex shader written in GLSL. So we have our standard inputs, which is the vertex position and the vertex normal, which you can get from a VBO. The output of this vertex shader is a color. So you will output one color for every vertex, right? So the input R is one vertex and one normal. So the vertex shader, as we know, acts on every vertex in your scene. And for that vertex, we will output a color from this vertex shader. We define the struct inside our shader. So first there is a struct called light info that is going to store the position, the ambient, diffuse and specular parts of the light intensity. So we are also breaking up the contribution the light source has in these components of the illumination model. And we have the material info, which is the various material coefficients Ka, Kd, Ks and the shininess coefficient. Instead of having LA, LD, LS, you could have had only one IL, which might have been the intensity of your light source, and you might have had the same light intensity in all the three components of the illumination model. So here we have chosen to have three different components represented separately. We define uniform variables of both struct types. So there might be multiple light sources. So that is given by light count. So we define an array of the type light info. The material of the surface for which you are passing a vertex is passed in this uniform variable called material. Then of course you are passing the model view matrix and the normal matrix and the model view projection matrix. So the model view matrix is just the product of the view matrix that you get from GLM lookat with the modeling transformations. The normal matrix is the left upper 3x3 matrix of the model view matrix. And the model view project matrix is the product of projection transformation that you might have computed using GLM perspective or frustum with the model view matrix. So first we set up some functions. First is this function called getIspace. So given the input normal and position, which is encoded in vertex normal and vertex position. So remember that when they enter the vertex shader, they are in WCS. So when I multiply it with the model view matrix, it gives me the vertex position in VCS. So position represents the vertex position in VCS. Norm represents the normal in VCS. Okay, so whatever model view does to the position, normal matrix does the same coordinate space transformation for the normal. So of course, for transferring the normal, we only need to apply the rotation part of the model view matrix and not the translation part, because it's a vector. So there will only be a change in direction. The reason we are moving to the VCS is because we will do all of our computation in the camera space or the view coordinate system. Why do we want to do this? Because it eases our computation as the eye is at the origin for VCS. So the calculation of the view vector becomes trivial. So remember, from the specular component, we need the view vector. So if you are in VCS, then the view vector, which would have otherwise been the position of the eye minus the position of the point on the surface, now the position of the eye is 0, 0, 0. So the view vector is just the negative of the position of the surface point. So we compute the light vector, which is the light position minus the position of the surface point. We compute the view vector, which is just the negative of the surface point, which is what we discussed just now. We compute the reflected vector using this function reflect that is there in GLSL. Then we compute the ambient component as LA into KA. We compute the diffuse component as KD, LD, L dot N, and we compute the specular component as KS, LS, R dot V raised to the power shininess. And we return the sum of the ambient, diffuse, and specular component as the return value of this function light that we find. And notice that it is returning a 3-vector because this computation is done in 3 channels. So the 3 components of this vector are the RGB components of the color value that this function is going to return. Finally, we have the main function of the shader. What does this function do? So what is called I space here, we call the VCS. It first figures out the normal and the position of the point, the surface point, or the vertex that was input to the shader in VCS or in I space. Then it initializes the output color variable to 000, and then it calls a light function for every light source and adds that to the color. Finally, it transforms the input vertex position to NDCS by multiplying with the model view project matrix, and color and GL underscore position are the 2 outputs that go from this vertex shader into the rasterizer. The rasterizer will take the positions, and there will be a primitive assembly before you hit the rasterizer. So you will get the triangle. The rasterizer will generate the pixels for those triangles, and it will automatically use scanline interpolation to interpolate the colors that you have computed here for the vertices to get the color for the generated pixels or fragments. Now, is there a disadvantage to using Borod shading? Is there some part of shading that Borod shading cannot capture? So first, let us look at a few advantages of Borod shading. We have already seen that it integrates very well with scanline rasterization, right? And if we had a surface that was made up of multiple polygons, so say a surface is made up of polygons 1, 2, 3, 4. So again, we are looking at a surface from the side, and these are the face normals, the ones I am marking with these 2 lines. And these are the vertex normals that you have computed by averaging the face normals. If you use the face normals to do faceted shading, then for every facet, you will compute a constant shade. So this is what you would have gotten as the intensity profile along a scan line for these faces. Whereas if you do Borod shading, you will do linear interpolation. So your intensity profile will look as follows. So obviously this intensity profile for Borod shading is better than what you do with faceted shading. Now assume that this faceted model, right, that was made up of these polygonal faces, was actually an approximation of a smooth surface. You computed the intensity using Borod shading at every pixel by interpolating between the vertices, which was a linear interpolation. What if there was a specular highlight that was contained entirely inside a face of your model? So in that case, the actual profile of intensity would have had this bump, right? There is no way for you to capture a intensity profile like this using Borod shading, because all Borod shading can do is linearly interpolate between IA and IB. There is no way for Borod shading to capture a highlight like this, that is smaller than the size of the facets. One way around this problem is, of course, to reduce the size of your facets. But that, as we know, causes the problem of too much geometry. That has to pass through your pipeline and that will slow down your rendering. So what is the solution? The solution is to do form shading or per pixel shading. In form shading, instead of interpolating colors from vertices, you instead take the vertex normals, pass the vertex normals to the rasterizer, and the normals are interpolated by the rasterizer to every pixel using the exact same scanline interpolation. Then compute color at 3 pixel using those per pixel normals. Again, I am emphasizing, note that this is called form shading and this is different from the form illumination model. So please do not confuse between form shading and form illumination model. Form shading refers to per pixel shading. Form illumination model refers to the illumination model that we have been using throughout our discussion of rendering so far. Okay, so there are two different things. So what is the kind of output that you can get by doing form shading? Well, you can get an output that looks this smooth. So you can see that at the large tessellation level, right, the lower tessellation level where you had the larger facets. So the facet size here is something like this, right? It is quite large. For the same facet size, if I instead do per pixel shading, I get a very smooth result. To get this result using Borel shading, you would have to reduce the size of the facet to the size of a pixel, which would be very, very expensive. Form shading is also expensive, more expensive than Borel shading, because you are doing the illumination computation at every pixel. But it is still more efficient than reducing the size of all facets to a pixel. I want you to think about why is it more efficient. So the question is that you can produce the same smooth rendering result by either using form shading, that is per pixel shading and larger facets, or by using Borel shading / faceted shading and using facets that are the size of a pixel. My claim is that form shading is more efficient. Why is that so? I want you to think about this question. How is form shading implemented? Well, you take all the shading code that you implemented for Borel shading in the vertex shader and just move it from the vertex shader to the fragment shader. The only thing that you need to pass as output from the vertex shader to the rasterizer along with the position of the vertex is the normal at the vertex. This will produce a normal for every pixel in the fragment shader. And using that normal, you can do your computation. So you can attempt to write your own per pixel shader in the fragment shader and see if you can make it work. Remember that we still do not have global illumination. Global illumination is actually very difficult to do in the rasterizing pipeline, whereas it comes naturally to ray tracing. Therefore, modern day rendering is trying to do ray tracing in real time. So you see all this discussion about real time ray tracing, the RTX extensions that are there in NVIDIA cards. And just today I have seen an announcement that real time ray tracing is also arrived on AMD cards. So why is there this urgency in bringing real time ray tracing to consumer grade GPUs? Because the kind of illumination effects that, or illumination transport effects that you can capture with global illumination produce much better looking images than you can produce by just doing direct illumination. So here are more examples of models that are rendered using faceted shading. So faceted shading result is shown in A, and the Godard shading result is shown in B, and the Phong shading result is shown in C. And the size of the facets or the tessellation level in all three is the same. So you can again see how the result improves from A to B to C. This brings us to the end of our discussion about shading in OpenGL. And we will continue with texture mapping in the next section. Thank you.